around the world with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor, Chief Medical Correspondent, and I'm joined here by one of the great friends of MS World, Dr. Sam Hunter, who is President of Advanced Neurosciences in Franklin, Tennessee. Dr. Hunter, Sam, you did a lot of research that was presented at this meeting, but one of the topics that we talked about here at the poster session had to do with a medication called alemtuzumab, or by the brand name of Lemtrada. Can you tell us a little bit more about what you found in your study?
So at this meeting, we were looking at complications of treatment. We're aware with many of our MS medicines that they do have some serious complications, and we try to understand what these are and these liabilities are. We've been following a number of patients who've gotten Lemtrada for 10 years, and we looked at this group of patients who is older and more disabled and more history of MS treatment, including many other prior treatments that aren't even approved, than most of the patients that have been studied in large research trials. So we looked at these patients and what kinds of complications they've had. And as far as hospitalizations go, about half the hospitalizations that people with MS have nothing to do really with the treatment they have. But the other half are due to infections or immune problems with Lemtrada. And these are known to occur. The infections we were interested in was serious infections, because these are older people and they have more long-standing MS and have had other drugs that slow their immune system down previously. And because the additive effect of Lemtrada has a liability to make that worse, we wanted to see. So what it translated to was, in terms of infections, early on, a fair number of people, about a third of people, were hospitalized in the first year or two for an infection. And so these were usually pneumonia or a bladder infection. Now, these are very straightforward to treat. There were a number of other infections that weren't particularly clearly related, but some were infections that were unusual infections that were not necessarily very serious, but required some additional experience because they were unusual organisms due to people's weakened immune system. And the one that we saw a couple times was one called histoplasma, which everyone has in our region, in Tennessee and the Ohio Valley areas. But in people with weaker immune system, it can get out of hand and cause pneumonia. So the important thing is it's all very straightforward. As far as immune things, which can occur and are watched for with alemtuzumab, Lemtrada, there was only about 20% of our patients had a thyroid problem, which was less than in the other trials, and they were split pretty evenly between low thyroid and high thyroid states. And two patients had to be hospitalized for overactive thyroid that required a few days in the hospital to stabilize. We also had two patients who had to be hospitalized for blood cell abnormalities, which were due to an immune problem. These immune problems happen because when the immune system is restarted, either when you have, you know, a lot of chemotherapy or a bone marrow transplant or Lemtrada, the immune system sometimes has other cells that get overrepresented and can cause these immune disorders. With Lemtrada, they're very brief and very treatable, but they do oftentimes require a few days in the hospital. So that's pretty much our, we had less of some problems, more of problems that we would expect to have for people having serious prior MS exposure to very toxic drugs, and also to being older patients.
So for the past several meetings, for the past several years, we've been presenting the safety data from this really important phase one trial, looking at people who are a little different than those who were studied in CARE-MS-1 and CARE-MS-2, the pivotal trials of alemtuzumab or Lemtrada. When can we start to expect to hear more about the efficacy, about the strength in those patients? Are we going to be hearing that in the next several years?
Well, we hope to have our results completely available by this time next year. We've done a look back at the group that's been on longest therapy, what we call a retrospective look back for people who had at least 5 years of treatment. And that group very clearly had changed dramatically in terms of their prognosis with MS. They'd improved on the average 30 percentile points in their prognosis. The average person improved by a point on our EDSS scale, which is a very significant improvement, and it was 75% of the people had improved. and the other 25% had gotten worse over 5 years. So there is no treatment that's perfect for MS, but this is a very effective one. And of course, the people who are at lower disability tend to do much better than the people at higher disability, like with many MS treatments.
Well, Dr. Hunter, as always, thank you for taking a complicated subject and helping us understand it better, and also focusing not just on the run-of-the-mill MS patient like we see in a lot of the clinical trials. We really do need more trials that look specifically at high disability, high frequency of relapsing patients with multiple sclerosis. Once again, thank you, Dr. Hunter, and thank you back home for tuning in.